Let's go that way then. So, good morning everybody, and I'm happy to talk a little bit about security. In this case about what we are doing at Nextcloud, what stuff we are... Sorry, something...
The mic works better if you...
Put it away?
You
so... That one. You see, I usually don't speak to microphones, so that is it. So I'm happy to talk about it, and I will go a little bit about what we have done at Nextcloud, what we are going to do, in what direction, and what we want to collaborate maybe with other vendors on, and improve the overall security of open source files and can share. So if you think about security, first of all, you need to realize that security bugs are actually pretty expensive. First of all, for us as a vendor, or for you as a vendor, if you have a product that is offered to millions of people, you may need to address logical issues in the software. There may be a vulnerability which requires you to rewrite large parts of the software, which is pretty expensive to do. And if you have like multiple lines of software products which you support, and multiple long-term support versions, then you need to backport the security patches, which is a very QA-intensive task, which means it's time-intensive, money-intensive, and if you don't have to do this, this would be quite nice. And actually for you as a user, as a university or NRM or whatever entity, data breaches and compliance can bring you in quite some issues, because you are actually going to your users and tell them, yeah, use our product instead of this public cloud service by some other big billion-dollar company, because we are secure, the data is in our own data center, etc., etc. But this statement, to have this statement too, you also need to be aware of the fact that your software needs to be secure and keep up to date and so on and so on. So what our strategy actually is to prevent and mitigate security problems earlier. So add as many hardenings to the product to make it as hard as possible to exploit security bugs. So some security bugs may not even be exploitable. So in the end, you may not have to issue a patch as soon as possible. You can take your time, which also helps the end users because they get a better tested product. So how do we achieve this? We have a strategy roughly aligned to the Microsoft security development lifecycle. We have it obviously shortened a little bit and adjusted to our use case because we're an open source project. We get lots and lots of external contributions. But obviously we have a detailed documentation about web security vulnerabilities. So if you go to our developer documentation, this is how it will look like. You have like security guidelines which are actually specific to the framework that we use. So as a developer, you can just go to this documentation, read it, and be aware of the security issues that you need to be aware of in particular, right? So this is something that I quite miss at other big open source projects, and if you have something like an app structure, you should consider doing this as well, because it does help. Then we do internal and public security trainings. So for example, this was last year at the Nextcloud Contributor Conference in Berlin, where we actually teach the people. This is how you do secure code. We give them an insecure web application that they have to hack themselves. So they learn and understand what are security issues, how can I address them, and so they know how to fix it. And we also have, by the way, a conference this year as well. If you're interested, this will be the domain. And if you, as a developer, have implemented a security issue by mistake, right? Then we mandate that you also fix it yourself, because then you only realize, oh, this was an issue, this is how I can fix it, and you probably will not do it again in future, which is quite a difference for some big companies where they have huge dedicated security teams which patch the security issues, but the single developers are not aware of the actual issues. So as part of the design life phase, which actually is like thinking about how you implement something, what impact has it, we obviously establish privacy and security requirements, so which feature may have which security impact, and we perform a rough threat modeling and attack surface analysis. So if you go to a website, we have like this fancy threat model. It's a little bit longer than obviously the screenshot here. And we are actually working on this with customers, because every customer has a different security requirement. One customer may be like, you may never share with another user or guess the username in any case, because the data privacy laws forbid you to enumerate usernames. And another customer may be, sharing has to be as easy as possible. So you always need to think about what is the middle ground and how can you compromise that both are happy, which is something that we are always quite happy to take input in. We perform permanent static and dynamic security scans. So a static security scan, this is an example of a software that we use. Basically, you put the source code in there, then it tries to find potential vulnerable functions that you are calling, and if it detects, oh, this could be user input, so you can potentially influence the vulnerable function with some malicious user input, this may be exploitable, it shows it to you, and we directly get a notification and can judge, yes, this is a vulnerability, no, this is not. Obviously, this doesn't replace manual testing, but it helps a lot to have also automated testing, and we use different kinds of software. This is another one, this is Coverity, the previous one was WIPS, and they are quite nice software, and by the way, this one is actually for free if you're an open source project, so you may want to consider using it if you have your own open source project. Then we also do dynamic security scanning, which means we actually run automated tests against the actual web application, but also manual testing, right? So what this software is basically Burp Suite, you set it against, you tell it, please attack this web application, it tries thousands of attack vectors automatically, and then it finds also some kind of vulnerabilities if you have done some mistake. Obviously, it doesn't replace manual testing as well, but helps also. And this is also not that expensive, so if you have an open source project, you can quite easily set this up into your continuous integration step. Something that we also need to do, which is a little bit different from many companies, is because we are open source based, everybody can contribute to the software, everybody can change something. And this is something which really, really happens a lot, I would say. Many of the contributions in OWN and Nextcloud came from the community, and this is quite some nice thing that I actually like. So how do we do the review process? So if somebody does a pull request, and want to change something in the software, they have to open like this pull request and describe, hey, I want to change this and that, and these are the reasons, and then they obviously have to sign the commit with, if they have some contribution rights, so to make sure that they are really they who they claim to be. And then two other of our core developers have to say, yes, this change looks good. So at least six people have looked at it. Once the person who has written it, twice the person who reviews it first, then the other person who reviews it. And only then it can be merged. Before the software that we use GitHub will basically tell you, oh, sorry, you can't merge this pull request. And this is something quite nice because in our model we have like everybody can actually commit to every branch except the stable and master one. So it makes it quite easy to collaborate with external people. Something else that we are actually implementing and also already have partly implemented is that we forbid unsafe functions. Unsafe functions means something which is a function which may be vulnerable if used wrongly. So for example, unserialize. Unserialize is totally fine itself, but if you put user input into it, it may end in a remote code execution. So there are other examples of that, non-prepared statements, unsafe comparisons. We have written automated tools that actually detect this kind of potential vulnerabilities. We also have it integrated into the CI environment, so we automatically detect such changes, and then it tells, oh, this is a potential insecure usage, please fix it, yeah? We once used the OCC tool that we have written, which uses the PHP parser, and then we also have a custom development based on the PHP parser itself, which is quite nice, and you can all find it on GitHub if you're interested. And obviously, it doesn't help to just forbid functions. You also need to make secure defaults for developers, because you need to make it as easy as possible for anybody to write secure code. It should actually be hard to make a mistake. So one example, this is the fancy application framework that we use for development. This shows the login form, so it returns a template response, which is nothing more except the layout of the login page. Or it returns a redirect response, which redirects you. It doesn't matter too much, right? But what you can see are these annotations. So we say add public page. Add public page means if you want to access this page, everybody can access it. And if you don't write this, then the page can only be accessed by administrators. Then we also do the same with the host-side request for rechecks. We basically say every controller method will be protected by XSLF protection except if you opt out. So if you make a mistake, you actually need to write the mistake manually, like, yes, I really do not want this security check, which is quite a difference to other frameworks where you have to write, yes, I want this security check. But opting out obviously makes it way easier for people to not fuck up as much as people may do, because we are all human beings, right? Then we have some other nice stuff like use session, where we basically say the PHP session can only be read but not written to, and stuff like that. We have like a huge list of annotations, and we are always improving them, which is a little bit hard because obviously you don't want to break compatibility, but you also want to move forward. Another example of secure defaults is the internal file system that we have. So this is a simple dummy function that I have coded, which accesses a folder. You basically say, give it a token and a path, and then you instantiate the view. So you say, I want to open the folder to change root, right? So this is the folder name. And then you say, oh, I want to open the file myfile.txt in this change root, and then it will tell perfectly fine, open the file and do everything you want with it. And what doesn't work is like this directory traversal attempt, because we believe it makes it a little bit harder for developers to implement stuff, because you can't use like this dot dot slash to traverse up. You have to instantiate another view and do stuff like that. But if this maybe user-controlled input, then this would be bad. So we just decide, let's be safe here and make it as hard as possible to make mistakes. Something else that we do is we have a quite successful bug bounty program with high payouts. We have launched it, I think, in June, right? We use the HackerOne platform, which is used by really, really many people and companies. So there are like more than 3,000 people on this platform which had reported vulnerabilities to some of these vendors. You probably know like most of them, and there are others on them that have a private profile. So with having a bug bounty program there, you get like huge traction by people that may never have heard of you, and they get the incentive to look at your software, report vulnerabilities to you, because obviously you are paying out money, which we also do. We offer some of the highest rewards in the open source world to our knowledge, which is something I'm quite proud of and happy about, so that's awesome. To put it in numbers, this is the rewards that we do offer. We offer up to 5,000 or something like that for remote code executions. Other software like Apache and Dropbox are in the same area, or Dropbox obviously much more. This is for Dropbox, it's a little bit different. This is the minimum reward for critical vulnerabilities, but obviously they are a $1 billion company and we are just a small German startup, right? But this is something quite nice if you compare it like with Apache, which is also widely used. So something nice. We are quite some people reviewing this stuff, actually. This is an old screenshot. They now have a new user interface and something like that, but we are like 9 people nowadays that actually review the vulnerabilities, which allows us to have a quite nice response time. So if somebody reports a vulnerability, usually it takes like 5 hours for us to respond, and then a little bit more to resolve, and to avoid money it also takes not so much. If this is something maybe interesting if you have your own product and want to consider launching a bug bounty program, this is the amount of reports that we get by, I think it's week. So this is when we launched, we got like 250 reports a week, which was quite annoying to try it. But, and obviously most of it is rubbish, right? But nowadays it's like 1 or 2 reports a week, which are also not all pretty useful, but at least you can easily do this at breakfast, take your mobile phone and be like, yes, valid vulnerability, or no, invalid vulnerability. And in terms of money, you see we have close 57 bucks, which may be valid, but actually paid out only for, I think, a few of them, 14, because only they were actually in the product and valid security issues. And in terms of money, this has cost us up to now roughly $4,000, which is, if you take it from a business point of view, quite economical value, because you cannot afford employing new people with $4,000. So quite a nice measure, not too expensive. So if you have your own product, consider doing it. I'm happy to talk about it with you as well. So what is the response, what we actually do if somebody has reported a vulnerability, how do we communicate it to people, what do we do to inform customers and so on and so on. So we do advisor always with CVE identifiers. So what this basically means, every vulnerability which is reported to us will be disclosed publicly at some point. And we disclose this publicly on our website, so you can go to the security advisory's up page, and then you have like a small description of what is the vulnerability about, how critical is it, like high, low, medium, what is the affected software with CVE and potential mitigation. So CVE is basically just a number which uniquely identifies the vulnerability. And this is just another number which uniquely identifies the type of vulnerability. So this can also be automated passed by like Nessus and stuff like that, which makes it quite handy to do. So if you have your own product, again, please do security advice always, because this is something that helps a lot. And usually we release advisories 14 days after a release, so we give people like 14 day time to update before we publicly tell, oh, this version is insecure. With customers, it depends a little bit. Obviously, we have like big customers with multiple millions of users, so this also receive ongoing mitigations before the general public. And we are always happy to talk about this with customers if they are interested. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about CSP and same-site cookies. Maybe a little bit of a more technical topic, and I have more slides of that if you're interested. I can show them to you in private, but I have not put them into the slide set because I'm already so far advanced in time, I guess. So some security features that we have added in Nextcloud in the last release and also before in OwnCloud, but have improved it over time. One example is content security policy. Content policy basically prevents the execution of inline JavaScript. So XSS attacks are not really feasible anymore. There are some kind of attacks that may still be possible, but we are working on mitigating them as well. So we have first implemented this in OwnCloud in 2013, and we have increased the policy, hardened it, make it even harder to make a successful exploitation of XSS issues in Nextcloud in late 2016. And you see, sometimes people say open source products are far behind like these big established companies which have dedicated security teams and implement security hardening. It's not always true, and obviously I don't even claim it's true at all. But for example, another competitor of us, which you all know, implemented this like in 2015, so like 2 years after us, which I also understand, because this is a huge change, and if you want to implement this, you need like 2 months just to get your software running again like before. What does it actually mean, like cross-site scripting? So cross-site scripting, very rough example, this is an input field, like you see in a web browser, which has a text field where you can enter your name. So it shows like, please enter your name, next to it there is this nice submit button. And this is basically then, if you enter your name and press submit, then it will show hello, and then your name. So like, hello, Christian, right? So, what actually happens if somebody uses a malicious username, and not like Christian, but something like script alert Frank or something like that, right? So then obviously it would show a pop-up, something like that, like this is a one and not a name actually. But this is actually bad, because if they can execute this kind of JavaScript in the context of your web application, then they can do like everything you can do in your web application as well. And I need to be a little bit quicker, but no problem for that. So we enforce a strict policy. And basically, this is how it looks in the browser later then. Supported by most browsers, except by one of the house of Redmond, like over there. Internet Explorer has not yet it, but Edge supports it. Then let's quickly show this slide as well. We also support same-site cookies, which will only be sent if the request originates from the source, from the same origin, which prevents XSRF vulnerabilities. And it's currently only supported in Chrome and Opera, and Mozilla is working on an implementation as well. What this basically means, there is like this new fancy technology where you can say this cookie is only sent from this same origin. And what this means is if I go to another website and this website sends a request to like Nextcloud in the background, then I can actually detect, oh, this cookie is not there. This is probably an attack attempt. Obviously, we also protect against XSRF vulnerabilities using other means, but this is a nice additional hardening that you can implement in like 2 weeks of development time, and it helps a lot. So, if you want to know more, we also have this fancy Nextcloud.com secure webpage, which with some, for example, the NCC group preview, which has done a security audit of the Nextcloud 11 release, the Vera code results, the results of the Linux Core Foundation initiative. And that's it from my side.
Okay, thank you very much. Very interesting presentation. So I believe there is only a space for a very short question. Okay.